In your class workbook, you'll find some information about what's going to be required during the install. You'll also find a bunch of screen prints. But let's just go ahead and I'll demonstrate what a server install looks like. So here I am back on my server machine. I've got that license.dat file. I just put it somewhere locally, somewhere arbitrary, doesn't matter where. And then I've also got the setup kit. Now my setup kit consists of this big, huge amount of files here along with a setup that runs it all. You may have just a single executable. It really depends on when you download it, where you downloaded it from, whether you got it on media that we ship to you, etc. So one way or another, just go ahead and run that setup. Now that during the PI Server 2010 install, we do require AF, so we warn you about that. PI AF is an integral component of the PI server now. So we warn you about that. It has to be up and running during the install. We will connect to it during the install. Now it doesn't have to be on the same machine. It can just be anywhere on the network, and typically it can be on a different machine. So for performance issues, that's of course a decision up to you where you install PI AF, but it has to be there and it has to be running. So I'll go ahead and acknowledge this. I'm going to take most of the defaults here. The first thing here we have to do is install the SDK, the software development kit. And you may or may not be prompted for things like where do you want to put this and what's the name of the default server. Yeah, I'm going to take the default here, program files PyPC. The only restriction about where you put the SDK is don't put it in the same directory as the PI server. That's not supported. I'll go ahead and just assume the default. As you can see, it already picked up my default server name. That's the name of my PI server. It is the same name as my AF server, you'll notice later on. I am putting the PI server on the same machine that's running the AF server, just for simplicity, but it doesn't have to be like that. Now, if there's anything running right now that needs to be shut down, we're going to go ahead and warn you about that at this point. I'll just go ahead and acknowledge to continue with the server install. Now, this is where we have the option of where we're going to be finding that license file. So I get to specify where it is. In my case, I had put it in a different directory. Yeah, there it is. So I'll go ahead and just identify the directory. We can't proceed with the install if that license file is not there. As I mentioned earlier, the AF server does have to be available to you on the network. The AF server is, in fact, on the same computer that I'm installing it on. So I'll go ahead and initiate a connection just to verify that it's there and it's running. And once we get that success message, I'll go ahead and click on Next. Now, this is an issue for those of you who have or upgrading from previous versions of PI, what to do with the module database. AF is our asset framework. It's our asset database, but it's not our first. We had one called the PI module database that's been used for years by customers to get, you know, huge value of doing asset relative displays, calculations, that type of thing. We do support the older asset database, module database, in AF. In fact, what you can do is just move everything into AF, and then basically AF becomes your new module database. And even, you know, it's synchronized in such a way that anything you do to AF anything you do from that point forward is going to go ahead and be propagated so that all the clients that require a module database are going to be aware of the changes you've made. Now, that's described in a lot better detail than what we're going to do in this particular video in a webinar that I'd like to point you to. If you go out to our website and look under webinars, that's going to be under resources, and then webinars, there's a series called the Show Me How webinar series in which we've presented just a variety of important topics for customers. Now, these webinars are only available to those of you who are on our SRP, our technical support agreement, and this particular webinar is all about the move from module database to AF. So it's a nice hour-long description of exactly what your options are with regard to moving to the new structure, to the new AF structure from the module database. Now, for those of you who are doing brand new installations like I am here, there is nothing to really recover, so we're just going to choose no. But if you do have something to recover, we do run an automatic. It's kind of a wizard that's going to step you through some of the choices you have and how you know, how we're going to move that asset database from the old structure to this new AF structure. I'll go ahead and say no and acknowledge that. Now this is just my user information. I'll just choose the defaults on that. And now this is where we're going to be putting PI. Typically the PI server is going to be in a PI directory. We traditionally over the years have organized it underneath root, but as you can see nowadays in this installation it's going under program files, so just go ahead and accept the default. Now one suggestion I would have for the PI server is you try to keep it off of any drive that's actively doing, you know, the kind of has the swap disk that you might use for your operating system's memory management. So, you know, typically C is going to be the same drive that's got your swap files on it, your you know, your memory management for the Windows operating system. And so if you had a drive D, then it would be a good idea to put that put PI on that drive D, so it's not competing for resources with your memory management. Now, there's this new option in PI Server 2010 to disable the traditional PI server passwords. PI server passwords, we've determined over the years there are some vulnerabilities to making use of the PI server passwords. When we originally came up with our PI server security, you know, we basically, I think we did this about 9 years ago. It was a proprietary algorithm for implementing security. And of course, it hasn't benefited from all the advances we've seen in security that Microsoft and others have brought to the table. So one of the things we do suggest, we do have full support for Windows integrated security, or we can do security basically using the concept of PI trusts, which we'll discuss later in the class. But one thing we give you the option to do is just disable these passwords, these imperfect passwords built on a technology that really is not state of the art when it comes to security. And so in this case, I would suggest, or we do encourage you, yes, go ahead and disable passwords. Unless you've got a huge install base and you're doing an upgrade and you're afraid that you don't have the time or the energy to do a proper transition from passwords to trusts or from passwords to Windows integrated security, then we suggest, unless that's the situation, we suggest you do disable these passwords.